In this module, we're talking about, I'm going to introduce the third law of thermodynamics, and then, really important stuff, we're going to talk about Gibbs free energy, symbol G. So first of all, the third law of thermodynamics says this, that if we have a perfect crystal, no imperfections, everything is in order, then at absolute zero, zero Kelvin, its entropy is exactly zero. Now, we can't get there, but what that allows us to do is that allows us to calculate the entropy of a crystal at other than zero by looking at the change. We can melt it, we can heat it up, we can boil it. So that's the third law of thermodynamics, and it's typically asked, so that's a good thing to remember. But now let's look at delta G, Gibbs, change in Gibbs free energy. So first of all, starting out with something we already know, that the condition for a process to be spontaneous is that the sum of the change in entropy for the system and the surroundings, that is, the change in entropy for the universe, has to be positive, greater than zero. That's what makes something spontaneous. Well, we know that the change in energy of the surroundings is equal to the negative change in enthalpy of the system over temperature, right? So if we just substitute that, you see what that does is that gives us everything on the right-hand side of the equal sign in terms of the system, which is really nice for us. And so because of that, let's do a little rearranging first. If we multiply through by a negative T and switch these two terms, we get negative T delta S of the universe equals delta H of the system minus T delta S of the system. And because the condition for spontaneity is that delta S of the universe has to be positive, negative T times delta S then must be negative or less than zero for the condition for it to be spontaneous. Or, in other words, delta H of the system minus T delta S of the system must be less than zero for a process to be spontaneous. So what Gibbs did is he defined a function G as being enthalpy of the system minus T times the entropy of the system, or the change in G, Gibbs free energy, what it's called, is equal to delta H of the system minus T delta S of the system at constant temperature and pressure. And that's how we're going to keep it for when we're talking about this stuff. Now, I'm going to stop writing system down here. If I don't write anything as a subscript for delta H or delta S, that means it's the system. If it's the surroundings, then I'll put that there. So now what we have as a condition for spontaneity is because delta H minus T delta S has to be less than zero for a process to be spontaneous, we can say delta G has to be less than zero for spontaneity. When delta G is equal to zero, that's the condition for equilibrium. That's when delta S of the universe is equal to zero, that's equilibrium. Now we have delta G is equal to zero. That's the condition for equilibrium. Important stuff. Memorize this, and this. Now if delta G is positive, all that means is that the process as written is not spontaneous, but the reverse process, if you reverse the reaction, the equation, that it's spontaneous in the opposite direction. So another thing we can get out of this, right? The condition for equilibrium, or another way of looking at this, the point at which a process goes from being spontaneous to non-spontaneous or vice versa is right when it goes from negative to positive or positive to negative. That's where delta G is equal to zero. If delta G is equal to zero, we can say delta H is equal to T delta S, right? Because delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. Or, rearranging that, the temperature that a process switches from being spontaneous to non-spontaneous and vice versa is equal to delta H of the system over delta S of the system. Really useful little equation there. Memorize this guy. So, for example, the heat of vaporization, delta H of vaporization, from mercury liquid going to gaseous mercury is this number right here. And the change in entropy for that process is this, joules per Kelvin mole. Now, when you're dealing with these guys here, watch out for units, because you're typically given entropies, changes in entropies in terms of joules per Kelvin mole. But the enthalpies are usually in kilojoules per mole, so you have to have consistent units. Anyway, so we're going to answer two questions from this. First, is this process spontaneous at 25 degrees Celsius? In other words, is delta G less than zero? Next, what is the normal boiling point of liquid mercury? Well, remember, the normal boiling point is the temperature at which a substance, the vapor pressure of liquid is equal to the vapor pressure above it at one atmosphere. But it's the boiling point, right, at one atmosphere. So what we're going to do is we're going to find, once we answer this question, we're going to find the temperature at which this process goes from being non-spontaneous to spontaneous, and that temperature will be the normal boiling point. So first, finding whether or not it's spontaneous, we take delta H minus T delta S. Temperature is 25 Celsius, so 298 Kelvin. I watch this, watch the units here. This was 92.92, I think, joules per Kelvin mole. I divided by 1,000 to convert it to kilojoules per Kelvin mole. Multiply this stuff out, subtract them, and I get positive 30.8. That's kilojoules per mole, by the way. But the point is that this is a positive number, which means that it's not spontaneous under those conditions. Next question, at what temperature is the normal boiling point? What temperature does it boil? Well, that temperature is where delta G is equal to zero, delta H over delta S is equal to T. Plugging those guys in, we get 629.7 or so Kelvin, converting to Celsius, 356.5 degrees Celsius. Next, we have a process, the reaction of iron solid, gaseous oxygen, liquid water to make iron 3 hydroxide solid. And it ends up that this becomes non-spontaneous at it goes from being spontaneous to non-spontaneous at this temperature right here. What we want to find is the entropy for iron 3 hydroxide. What we're going to do, okay, given this information here, heat of formation of liquid water, heat of formation of iron 3 hydroxide, the entropies of these three guys here, and we want to find the entropy of this. Right? So first of all, let's go over here. The temperature that we're given, that's the point at which it switches from being spontaneous to non-spontaneous and vice versa. That's the temperature at which T is equal to delta H over delta S. So converting to Kelvin, we get this guy right here. We're using Hess's law here, delta H. It's products minus reactants, each times their coefficients. Now, let's remind you about something from Chem 101 here. Notice that I didn't give you guys the heats of formation of iron solid and oxygen gas. That's because the heat of formation of an element in its standard form is defined as being zero. So these are zero, you're not given them, but you should know that they are zero so you don't, you know, try to figure it out or something. All right, so using Hess's law, products minus reactants each times their coefficient, I get the delta H of reaction, negative 1582 kilojoules per mole. Rearranging this, change in entropy is delta H over T. Take my delta H over the temperature, and I get negative 0.71169 kilojoules per Kelvin mole, or converting that to, joules, that should be joules down here, not Kelvin, converting to joules per Kelvin mole, we get negative 711.7 joules per Kelvin mole. Now, that's our delta S, and you know, just like Hess's law, it's the entropies of the products each multiplied by their coefficient minus the entropies of the reactants each multiplied by their coefficient. Well, this is what we're trying to find. So that's going to be our unknown. I gave you the entropies of all these guys. We just calculated this by delta H over T. That's this guy right here. And so, plugging these numbers in, rearranging, we get the entropy of iron 3 hydroxide solid as being about 108 joules per Kelvin mole.